the most important thing that I try to pass on is the sense that economics is an empirical field. And if you get new empirical evidence, you're going to have to change the way you think about the economy. And I think being open to that is the most important thing for a young economist to know.
Economists, not a group with a lot of Marys, Natashas, or Juanitas. And that's caused a lot of controversy. However, what's often overlooked are the actual female economists who are pushing economics forward by addressing real-world issues. Welcome to Women in Economics.
I grew up in a family where public policy was discussed a lot. I was planning to be a lawyer.
A meeting place for her business.
So I was going to major in government. And as part of the government major at my college, you had to take a year of economics. And I was about 3 weeks in and I was hooked. Like, no, the government major is gone, the lawyer is gone. I was an economist.
Christina Romer is a macroeconomic historian. She takes the tools of modern economics, statistics, and data and applies them to historical questions.
Christie's research agenda throughout her career has focused on a core set of topics about economic fluctuations and business cycles.
She's been asking and answering fascinating questions about our economy, starting with her dissertation as a graduate student at MIT. There, she changed our understanding of how the economy has grown over time.
I think the questions that came to me were about monetary policy and business cycles and the Great Depression.
It was widely believed that government policies led to less fluctuations in unemployment after World War II. However, the data before World War II was unreliable.
But Christie came up with the ingenious insight that while you couldn't clean up the historical data, you could fuzzy up the more modern data. And that's exactly what she did. And when she did it, lo and behold, all these differences basically collapsed.
Amazingly, if she applied the old techniques to the new data, the post-World War II economy looked just as volatile as the pre-World War II economy. This contradicted the consensus on the role of government stabilization policies. Her research rattled the economic community.
It made a splash. I remember one of the prominent economists at MIT, his first reaction was, well, I'd be very upset about this if I believed it, so I'm not going to believe it.
Throughout her academic career, Christina continued to challenge our understanding of the Great Depression. As just one example, most economists believed the Great Depression ended because of higher government spending and investment in public works. She showed that the impact of those policies were relatively small compared to the monetary policy changes taking place.
Starting as soon as Roosevelt took the U.S. off the gold standard when he took office in 1933, over the next decade, there's just an enormous increase in the money supply. What she showed was that that is what caused the very rapid growth that we had.
Christina's research has often focused on the effect economic events have on people's everyday lives.
It's tough to manage to have new ideas on the same thing again and again and again. And one of the remarkable things about Christy and David's research program is that they have done that very successfully.
Over 35 years, Christina has done meticulous research, frequently with her collaborator and husband, David Romer.
We'll have a paper, and I think it's almost done. You know, we've worked really hard on it, and you know, each do one last read. She says, you know, I think there's a logical tension between where we end up in section 4B and how we set out what we're going to do in section 2A. And I'm thinking, oh, no one's going to notice. And we spend, you know, weeks more on the paper because she's right. And the paper gets much better.
One of the remarkable things about her work is the coherence that spans literally her graduate school days and her work on her dissertation, and connects up to some of her most recent work on thinking about ways of identifying turning points in the economy.
Christina's work would be put to the test during the devastating crash of 2008.
Nobody could believe it.
When the U.S. economy was in freefall.
We often describe the economy as, you know, we were at the edge of a cliff. Well, the truth is, we were not only at the edge of the cliff, we were headed down.
Financial markets were plunging, and the risk of contagion from the U.S. to the global economy was very real.
Even people who'd seen a lot were really worried about what was happening.
Just as the nation was turning to President-elect Obama to confront the economic crisis, a mysterious email showed up in Christina's inbox with the subject line, Obama Transition.
And I will take a little bit of credit here because Christina was just about to delete it. And I said, why don't you at least Google the person? And she discovered that he was the head of the economic side of the transition.
The Obama administration wanted to meet with Christina as soon as possible.
And on the next day, she was on a plane to Chicago to meet with the president-elect.
Christina was asked to chair the Council of Economic Advisors. The council was set up to bring academics into the policymaking process and make recommendations to the president.
I was talking to Rahm Emanuel and I said, so tell me again, how did I get this job? And he said, you were an expert on the Great Depression and we thought we might need one.
She's tried to understand what caused the depression, what ended the depression, what role monetary and fiscal policy could play, and no one could have been better positioned to know what the right strategy would be.
We were talking to bankers, we were talking to employers, we were talking to the people that were collecting the statistics.
Christina's research revealed that the economy was in even more of a perilous position than previously thought. She got on the phone with Obama to give him the bad news.
So you're going, this is terrible. We've lost 750,000 jobs. I'm just going on like this. And finally he stops me and he said, Christy, it's not your fault yet.
The challenge that Christy and her other team members on the economic advisory team confronted was how large a stimulus the U.S. economy needed in order to right the ship. And trying to calibrate that depended critically on the estimates of how much bang for the buck you get when you use fiscal policy as a tool and try to then reflate the economy.
Christina helped design a fiscal package that she thought was necessary to get the economy moving.
The American Recovery and Reinvestment Act was a piece of legislation that was signed in February of 2009. And it was a combination of direct government spending, so think of repairing highways, transfers to state governments, transfers to individuals, and tax cuts. And the rationale for it was at a time when households were spending less and businesses were spending less, that's a time when it's appropriate for government to spend a little more to fill in that gap. Recessions leave long scars, and people who lose their jobs during recessions and are unemployed for a while, even 10 years later, often are earning less than they were before the recession occurred. And so by making the case, both in academic research and then as a policymaker, that the government could do more to mitigate recessions, that really has an impact.
Probably hundreds of thousands of people kept their jobs during the Great Recession because she had become an expert on the behavior of the economy, on the effects of fiscal policy.
And she was really passionate about the role that she played after the financial crisis and the Great Recession and fought passionately for policies that would address the 9 million people who lost their jobs and get the economy moving.
Christy was a very fortunate person to have in that role because much of her work academically over the 25 years before that had been focused on trying to understand the nature of the linkages between fiscal policy, monetary policy, and economic outcomes.
So that's an unusual case where you can really see a pretty direct connection between sort of, you know, ivory tower research and real lives on a big scale.
Romer's work at Berkeley continues to ask and answer these important questions about the macroeconomy.
If you think about what matters to a typical person, do they have a job? Can they support their family? Can they give their children a better life than they themselves had? You realize that economic issues, how well the economy operates, is probably one of the things that affects people's lives more than anything else.
Want to better understand Romer and business cycles? Click here for related materials and practice questions. Or check out other videos on how economists are tackling all sorts of issues, ranging from weighty topics such as the macroeconomy to everyday items like Wikipedia and wine. Yes, even wine.